Hi folks, hope everybody's okay. It's good to be with you. We're looking at Romans chapter 8. So it's good to be with you. So if you'd like to turn to the Bible, Romans chapter 8, and let's come before the Lord. Father, we thank you for this day, and we give you the prayers, we give you the glory, we give you the honor. And Father, we pray as we look at your word today that you bless us for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Don't forget to look at my website, jasonburnspreacher.com. 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 It's good to be with you and hope you're okay today and love to you and your family today. So we're looking at Romans chapter 8. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. But the law of the Spirit of life is Christ, in Christ Jesus, hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is at enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can it be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you, now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh. For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willing, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same into hope, in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is no hope, for what man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that which we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose, for whom he did foreknow, he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. More whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. What shall then we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who is also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long, we are accounted as sheep of the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Pray that God will bless his word, and we have a great God. We have a mighty God today. Imagine a lady, this is actually a true story. There was a lady who was 80 years of age, got a call to be a missionary in Uganda. She came from the UK, she was 80 years of age, she became a missionary in Uganda. And it shows pictures of this lady where there are little children who are sleeping rough in little shacks with no parents, no family. And this woman took them in and befriended them. This was just after Idi Amin's atrocities. And she looked after them, and these babies and young children became adults. They grew, they became fine young people. They became doctors, and they became nurses, and the love that she showed was a blessing to them. And in a way, when we become a child of God, there is this tremendous love that God has for us. The Bible calls it the doctrine of adoption. If you turn to Romans 8:15, for you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. We're adopted into the family of God. If you look at Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, it says, but when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the, what? Adoption of sons. And because you are sons, God has set forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. We're adopted into the family of God the day we believe in Jesus Christ. And I want us to think about the love of God in our lives today. Can you say today that you know in your heart that you're loved by God? A lot of the problems that we face in our life is not the circumstances. You might say, well, I've got an issue in my life, a spiritual issue that I'm struggling with. Or you might say, providentially, there are things in my life that are difficult, I'm suffering. But if you know that you are loved by God, there will be a peace and a strength and a tenacity to be able to deal with the issues that you face. And the question is, do you know that you are loved by God? Do you know that? And if you know that, everything else will fall into place. Number one, God's love is legally binding. God's love is legally binding. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 to 3, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. We've seen Trump question whether Obama was an original, an American. And Obama's had to prove it with his birth certificate. And as he brought his birth certificate, he proves that he's an American. Well, you have a birth certificate that is legally binding. And that birth certificate is that you're justified by faith. And that doctrine goes right through this book. It permeates every chapter. It is like a golden bar that runs right through the book. That we are justified by faith. If you turn to Romans chapter 3, verse 23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We are sinners. Not one person deserves salvation. Not one person is saved by good works. Romans 3:24. being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. The justification by faith is about the justice of God. God gave a law. Don't lie, don't steal, don't commit adultery. God gave a law. And we break that law, and God has to uphold his justice. So he punishes when we break the law. But what he did is he took our punishment. He took our judgment. He took the wrath that we deserved. And the justice of God was appeased. And righteousness was established because he took the judgment, the punishment for us. So he who became sin knew no sin. Jesus knew no sin. Jesus was perfect. He was holy and pure and undefiled, and yet he died in yours and my place, taking the wrath that you and I deserved. And that is justification by faith. As I have faith in Jesus, I am declared right before Almighty God, not because of my righteousness, but because of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus is put to my account. My faith does not justify me. My faith receives the justification in Jesus. And so what that means is that no amount of good works can establish you before God, justify you. No. Paul was a very, very godly man in Judaism. He was very godly, but yet he was a vile sinner. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 16, it says, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. You cannot justify yourself by obedience to the law. You become condemned. And so Christ was condemned in your place. So now there is no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. And this is legally binding. In other words, you are declared right before God, and nobody can condemn you, nobody can judge you and say that you're not saved. If you have trusted in the Lord as your Savior, you are forgiven, you are cleansed, you are washed, you are now a new child of God. It is legally legit if you put your faith in Him. Your blessings, all the blessings that you have as a child of God, all the glorious blessings of being a child of God are because of Christ and all that he has done for you. No man can get the glory. Nobody can get the glory, but Christ gets the glory. God gets the glory. And so, God's love is legally binding. In other words, that we're justified by faith. By Christ's death and resurrection is put to our account. And we have a glorious, solid foundation in the Messiah, in Jesus Christ the Lord. No devil, no demon, no nothing that comes against your faith can conquer that foundation that you have in Jesus Christ the Lord. You are safe in his arms because your ground, your foundation, is the rock of Christ and all that he's done for you. What a glorious Savior. And number two, God's love provides spiritual help. God's love provides spiritual help. God's love provides spiritual help. Derek Thomas, a minister in a Presbyterian denomination, tells the story. He was moving to a house and somebody gave him a piano, and he wanted to get this piano in his new house. He couldn't do it. He couldn't lift it up the seven stairs into the house. So he calls upon the deacons, and the young men come, and they grab the piano and they push it, and it's as almost he's holding it, but they're doing the work. They're pushing it up and into the house. And that is what it is to know God. We are to do things, but God is moving powerfully by the Holy Spirit. Romans 8 verse 9, we have the Holy Spirit. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is not of his. Notice this, the Trinity. But you are not, but you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God, that is the Spirit of God the Father, dwelleth in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, so the Spirit of God the Father, the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. But he said, but you are not in the flesh. So there's the Trinity there. But anyhow, verse 9, but if you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. You see, when you become a child of God, you become a recipient of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God. And the Holy Spirit gives us help. Romans 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. The Spirit of God moves and works in our life when we're weak, when we're tired, when we can't do things. The Spirit of God will help us. There's a story of in Jerusalem, a Jewish, Orthodox Jewish father and his son were running to the Wailing Wall to pray, and the little boy was trailing behind, and suddenly the Jewish, Orthodox Jewish father picked up his son and ran with him, and the little boy said, Abba, which means father, and the father held his son tight as he ran with him, and that is what the Holy Spirit does. It bear witnesses with our spirit that God is our Father. Romans 8:15. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. Verse 16, the Spirit itself bear witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. You see, when we come to know the Lord, it's an experience. You experience God. And it's a wonderful thing. Romans 8, verse 23, we groan in the Spirit, and not only they, but ourselves, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves grown within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. We are adopted now, but we will be adopted in the future. What does that mean? It's like a boy, you adopt a boy, and they get the blessings of the adoption. They live in your house, they live and enjoy the privileges of being in your family. But one day, when they reach to 18, 19, 20, they inherit your house and money. And so right now we're adopted in the family of God. We have an inheritance of the Holy Spirit right now. But one day we'll have the full inheritance in glory. These are the great privileges of knowing God. So imagine you adopt 7 children and they come to your house and they live in your house and you never hug them, you never say you love them, you never show any affection to them, and then one day you realize that you're not doing that, and you hug them and you kiss them and you tell them that you love them, that they're your children. This is what Romans 8 is doing. God is giving you a hug, he's giving you a kiss, and he's telling you, I love you, you are my child. And the Holy Spirit is the kiss of God. The Holy Spirit is the hug of God. The Holy Spirit is saying to you, in your experience, I love you. But when the Holy Spirit is given and God helps us, shows his love by helping us with the Holy Spirit, it's not let go and let God. There are people that say, well, I have the Holy Spirit and I just let go and he'll sort everything out for me. No, no. Romans 8:13. For if after the flesh you shall die, but if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. If you do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. Mortification. It's kind of like this. What is it saying here? It's saying this. Imagine a father and a son move into a house. The son's about 8-9 years of age. In the front room is a coal fire with an iron front. So the father knocks it out. He wants to put an electric fire. He knocks the old iron fire out, but then it leaves lots of dirt on the carpet and on the floor. And so the father takes the iron out, throws it in the skip, but the dust, he says, son, you clean that up. That's what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit comes and He carries most of the weight, just like the father carries the iron. But then the son has to clean up, and so you have a responsibility. As the Holy Spirit works in you, you have a responsibility to clean things up in your life. You see, you can't blame God. You say, well, God, I wish God would help me with this sin. I wish God would help me with that sin. And I keep falling into it. I keep falling into it. And I've been doing this, and I wish God would help me. And God's saying to you, I've given you all the power. I've given you the power of the Holy Spirit. You need to mortify your flesh. You need to clean things up in your life. But no. It's not my fault. It's your fault, God. I have these sins. I can't stop. No. God's saying, I have given you the power of my Holy Spirit. And you can do all things in Christ. You can do it. You can overcome. I have given you power of the Holy Spirit. I have given you my Holy Spirit, and you can overcome. So why is it you keep sinning? It's because you're letting your mind feast upon the flesh rather than feast upon the Spirit. You're letting your mind be dragged down by the flesh rather than focusing your mind, which is now in the Spirit of God. That is the problem. So when you get tempted, when a temptation comes, you've got a choice. You can either dwell in the Spirit and dwell on the things of God, or dwell more and more on this fleshly thing, which will pull you down. What you have to do is recognize when the temptation comes, you have all power. You have the Holy Spirit. And He is in you, and He is filling you, and He is there with you. But you have to feed your mind upon the Spirit of God and the things of God and the Word of God. It's at that moment when the flesh is fed, you will sin. So you mustn't feed the flesh, but feed the Spirit. Feed the spiritual man. And so there is no excuse. There is no excuse. We can overcome sin in our lives. We can overcome. So you might be in despair today. You might be so down and saying, Jason, I have sinned and sinned. And there's this sin I cannot beat. Or there's this issue I cannot deal with in my life. And it defeats me and defeats me. And it makes me wonder whether I'm a Christian or not. It makes me wonder whether God loves me. It makes me wonder whether I'll ever get victory in this area of my life. And I want to tell you, you have the victory in this situation. You already have the victory in this situation because you've been adopted into His family. And if you've been adopted into His family, He is now giving you the Holy Spirit. And if you have the Holy Spirit, you can do all things in Christ. You will overcome this problem. You will overcome the difficulty. You will be victorious in your Christian life because you have the Spirit of God in your life. He is a present reality now. But you say, well, Jay, it doesn't seem like it's a reality. I keep failing. I keep making mistakes. It doesn't seem like it's a reality because you're not walking in the reality. You have to walk in the reality. You have to see yourself as adopted. You have to see yourself as the Holy Spirit in you right now. You have to understand that is the truth of you that God tells you. The Holy Spirit is now in you and working in you to sanctify you. So cooperate with the Spirit of God. Enjoy the Spirit of God. Revel in the things of God. And know that your mind is to focus on the things of God. And when a temptation comes, you have a choice. Either feed your mind on the flesh, or turn your mind to the spiritual nature and things of God in your heart and in the Word. You have all the resources that you need. So don't be discouraged, don't be down, don't feel that you cannot be victorious, because you can. God is, what father would adopt a child? What millionaire father would adopt a child and let his child walk in poverty or walking in struggling. The father will do everything in his power to help his child and to love his child. But God has done everything in his power to provide you with the resource to get victory in your life, and that is the Holy Spirit. He has given you all the resource that you need. He's not a God who's going to pamper you. He's not a God who's going to say, well, there's never going to be any suffering in your life. There might be suffering on the way or in your life even now. I'm not saying that you're not going to suffer, because sometimes we do. But what I'm saying is, you don't have to feel that in your failure and mistakes that you make in your sanctification, in your growing as a Christian, and you might fall into sin or fall into a sinful pattern. You need to know that that is not where God wants you to be. That God has something far, far more better for you, and that is to be in the Spirit. And to enjoy the things of the Spirit. To walk in the Spirit. And it's a wonderful thing, but you have to take your responsibility. We have to take our responsibility, and that is to mortify our flesh. That is to clean ourselves up and realize that we're no longer what we used to be. We are new creatures in Christ, and we have a glorious heritage. We have a glorious faith. We have a glorious salvation, and we have magnificent provision from God in the Holy Spirit. So we've looked at God's love is legally binding. God's love provides spiritual help. And thirdly, God's love is secure. God's love is secure. Imagine an adopted child, a boy. Well, we'll pick a girl this time. A girl of 13 years of age goes to school, and the teacher doesn't like this girl, and the teacher sticks a sticker on the girl saying she's stupid, and then other students join in, and they stick stickers on there, and they've written idiot, ugly, thick, and all these derogatory terms, and she's got all, the end of the day, she's got all these stickers that tell her how idiotic and stupid and foolish she is, stickers all over, these white stickers with writing on saying you're stupid, you're daft, you're thick, you're all this. She gets home, mum and dad see all these stickers, they pull every single one off, and they give her a hug and they say, you are our daughter and we love you. The father says, you are my daughter and I love you. People might put labels on you. They might stick labels on you, and they might say that you're this or you're that, or whatever label people have put on you. Your father wants to tell you today he loves you, that you're his child, and he loves you. And no matter how many labels people have put upon you, the greatest label that is on your forehead and every part of your body from inch to toe is this, that God is your father and he loves you. Turn to Romans chapter 8, verse 28 to 30. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. Verse 28. And we know that all things work together. Did I hear that right? Did we hear that right? Listen again. And we know that all things work together. Did he say some? No. He said all things work together for good. Any evil that has come into your life, any evil that has tried to bring you down, any evil that has tried to trip you up, anything that has come against you in your life, it says this. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God. God is using anything in your life that is trying to pull you down and trying to hurt you. He's over it and he's in control and he's using it for your good. That his love is with you And no evil, no malice, nothing that has come against you in any way can ever take away the love that God has for you. And that God can turn all the schemes of the wicked that have come against you on their own head and bring you out of that situation and be a blessing to you. It says, 28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. If you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 9. God is faithful, by whom we are called unto the fellowship of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord. We are called. God called you. It wasn't you who came to God, but God came to you first. God called you. Every motion that's in you spiritually started first with God's call in your life. Verse 29, Romans 8, 29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate. The Greek there foreknow means intimate love and knowing beforehand. So knowing beforehand intimately with love. Genesis chapter 4 verse 1 talks about Adam knew Eve. It's this same Hebrew word that is similar to the Greek word here. And it has the idea of intimate knowing. Jeremiah 1:5, if you turn to Jeremiah 1:5. Says, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou camest from out of thy womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nation. Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. I knew thee. Again, He knew intimately Jeremiah before he was even born. What it means is this, is that there's been a love for you from the beginning of time. That God had a love for you before the beginning of time. And this love is working out in time and it's working out in the future. And nothing or nobody's going to stop this love working in your life. Not any circumstances, not any frustrations in your life, not any enemy against you, nothing is going to frustrate God's love and intention for you in your life. Romans 8 verse 30. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, whom he called, them he also justified, whom he justified, them he also glorified. Predestinate, predetermined beforehand. God predetermined your salvation beforehand. You were not saved in eternity. You were chosen in eternity and saved in time. But in eternity, God chose you before you were even born. That is the doctrine of predestination. And it's very clear in Scripture. We have to be careful that we come to Scripture and let Scripture speak. If we come to Scripture with a worldly logic, if we have a worldly logic, the way men think, and we come to the Bible with a worldly logic, we will deduce things and not take in the balance of Scripture. But if you come with an honest heart and you search the Scriptures, you will find Scriptures like this that baffle the human intellect, that baffle the worldly kind of logic. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 4. According, he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love. It's very clear that we were chosen before we were even born. Verse 5, having predestined us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. It was God's will and pleasure that he, before I was born, to choose me that I might be saved. It was God's pleasure and will before you were born that he would choose you and save you. That is predestination. Verse 11. Ephesians 1 verse 11. in whom we also have obtained an inheritance, being predestined according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will. You cannot get any clearer than that. That everything, he says, all things work together to the counsel of his will. And my salvation and your salvation was according to the counsel and plan and purposes of God. That is marvellous. Now, if you go back to Romans 8, verse 28, notice this. We know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. So God mentions his purpose. Now, this purpose is that moves into eternity. That there was an eternal plan. Verse 29, for whom God did foreknow, he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son. So there is this eternal plan of predestination. But then this plan works in time. Verse 30. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he called, him he called, he justified, them he glorified. So now the eternal plan of predestination is worked out in time through the call, justification, adoption, and glorification. Now imagine a rabbit and an elephant were having a tug of war. We have an elephant and a white rabbit. A greyish looking elephant and a white rabbit. And they have a rope on each other. And who's going to win the tug of war between the elephant and the white rabbit? The elephant. What these passages are saying in verse 28 to 30 is that God's will cannot be thwarted. That God has a plan for his people. And that plan will be carried out no matter what. He will have his people. He will save his people. What that means is nothing is ever going to take you out of God's hands. Nothing is ever going to break that love that God has for you in your life. Nothing. You are secure in the love of God today. You might be going through suffering and pain. You might be going through attack or criticism. You might have lost your job. You might have bad health. You might be going through a really, 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 really bad time. I mean, really bad. I mean, you're so discouraged, so depressed, so down. You're so disappointed at Christians. They've not been what they should have been. You're so disappointed with church. You're so disappointed with God. He's not come up trumps. It doesn't seem as if he cares. You've been battling with problem after problem after problem, and your heart's broken, and you just feel like giving up, and you just don't feel that God is with you. And God is telling you today that there is an absolute iron love for you. A love that predestined you. A love that chose you before you were even born. And now is working in you and will not give up on you. And is going to bring you to flourishing, to glorification. So whatever's going on in your life right now, all things work together for good to them that love God. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. You turn to John chapter 6, 44. Again, it's important to realize that when we come to Scripture, not to come to Scripture with our own logic, but to let Scripture speak for itself. And when you let Scripture speak for itself, it causes you to really be shaken. Like John 6, 44, 45, most Christians will find these verses very difficult to take. But I tell you this, ask yourself, are they in the Scriptures or not? And if they're in the Scriptures, you have to accept them and try to trust, and not try, but to trust in the Word of God, knows what God wants and is teaching. And that His Word is infallible and it is above your mind. And if His Word teaches something, you have to submit to what it's saying. John 6, 44 says, no man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. Nobody can come to the Father unless the Father draw him. Verse 45, it is written in the prophets, and they shall be all talk of God. Every man Therefore, who have heard and have learned of the Father cometh unto me. We come to the Father not because of us, but because the Father works in us. That's what those passages are saying. Nothing can stop God's will working in your life. So don't be discouraged, don't be down. I know you've got a lot of pressures, you've got a lot of challenges, but there's a love that is holding you tight and strong right now. Though you feel weak and you feel like you want to give up and you feel like throwing in the towel, you think, well, why don't I become a Muslim, or why don't I become a Mormon, or why don't I join the Jehovah's Witnesses, or what is the whole point of it? Why don't I just become an atheist? And I want to tell you, you can't do that, because the Lord died for you. He shed his blood for you. The Lord loves you so much, and he holds you right now solidly in his arms. A vast, mighty, strong love that nothing can conquer or rip you apart, because God holds you in his hands. Do you remember John 3:16? It says this, for God so loved the world. Notice this, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Notice, for God so loved the world. Now you gave your heart to the Lord. So, for God so loved you. You know, when the Lord died on that cross, he didn't just die reluctantly, in the sense that begrudgingly. And the Father didn't send him begrudgingly. It wasn't like, oh, the Father was thinking, oh, I don't really want to save them, I'm not too keen, don't really want to do this, don't really want to send my son. No, for God so loved, he did it out of love. Oh, I love them, I love them, oh, I'll pay the price for them. Oh, I love them so much. And he loved you so much that he paid the ransom for your sin. Romans 8:32. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? He that spared not his own son, the Greek word spared there is a word almost that Paul invented. It wasn't used much in the ancient world. But if you go back to Genesis 22, it was used in Hebrew concerning Abraham. It was used concerning Abraham. He was about to sacrifice his son, but God spared his son. But here he did not spare his own son. He gave his son to die for you, that you may live. You are loved today. And I want to ask this question, and I want you to meditate on it all week. I want you to read every day for a week, or even for a month. Read it every day for a month, Romans 8. And if you want to study more depth, go to Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones Recording Trust, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones Recording Trust, and listen to the sermons of Lloyd-Jones every day for a month on Romans 8. And read Romans 8 every day. And ask the Lord to feed your mind with a love for him. And ask the Lord to really impress upon you his love for you. Because when you realize how much God loves you, a lot of the issues that you're facing will melt away. Because a lot of them are down to us not accepting ourselves before God. So the question is, do you know that you're loved by God today, that he loves you so much? He's provided the Holy Spirit, he's given you a legal grounded in justification by faith. He has provided for you the Holy Spirit and all the provision of the Holy Spirit to help you in your infirmities and your struggles. And he providentially, he has said that all things work together for good, that nothing will ever, ever, ever take you away from his love. I know things are not easy sometimes for you, but you have such riches of his grace to meditate on tonight through his word. Listen to Lloyd-Jones, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones Recording Trust. Listen to his sermons on Romans 8. every day for a month and read Romans chapter 8 every day for a month and meditate and say, Lord, help me to believe that you love me. Implant in my heart and in my life a sense that you love me. And you'll see great change in your life. You'll see great blessing in your life. You'll see a big difference in your sanctification. You'll see a big difference in every area of your life when you are confident and resting in the fact that God loves you. Okay? Let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. And we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your encouragement. We thank you for your grace. And we just give you the praise. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. And we thank you for your goodness and all your blessings to us, Lord. And we just praise you and we honor you and we magnify your name. And Father, I pray for those who heard your word today that they would know your love in their life, that they would really know that you love them. Oh, Father, thank you for being so kind to us, so gracious. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Just get a glass of water. I'm going to sing a song and I'll just talk about a few things just for a few minutes. In heavenly love abiding, no change my heart shall fear. And safe is such confiding, for nothing changes here. The storm may roar without me, my heart may low be laid, but God is round about me. And can I be dismayed? Wherever he may guide me, no one shall turn me back. My shepherd is before me, and nothing can I lack. His wisdom ever waketh, his sight is ever dim. He knows the way he taketh, and I will walk with him. Green pastures are before me, which yet I have not seen. Bright skies will soon be o'er me, where the dark clouds have been. My hope I cannot measure, my path to life is free. My Savior has my treasure, and he will walk with me. Don't give up. Don't get discouraged. Don't get down. Don't be broken. Don't feel you're down and out. It's just beginning. Your journey is just beginning. There are going to be better days for you. It's going to be a better day for you, so do not fear or think that you are out of the picture. No, no. God is working in your life and you will get through this situation. You will go forward and you'll be okay. You will be okay, I promise. Don't do it your way, but do it his way. Now, I want to talk about a few things in this video. First of all, I want to talk about this. The Westminster Confession, the larger confession. You can get this at the Banner of Truth. It's published by the Free Presbyterian Publication. And I'd encourage you, whether you're a young Christian or been in the Christianity for a few years, or if you're thinking about issues about teaching in Christianity, what does Christianity teach, what's the Bible about, get hold of a confession. There's 199. Or get in contact with me. You can get in contact with me from jasonburnspreacher.com. Phone me up, and if you want one, I'll send you a copy. Alright? But get in touch with the Banner of Truth, and you can buy one for £1.99. And they're really, really wonderful. It's a real wonderful statement of faith. And on the doctrine of adoption that we've looked at tonight, that is very, very helpful. So I'd encourage you to get a copy. Also, you can download a PDF of Shaw's exposition of the Westminster Confession. Shaw's exposition of the Westminster Confession is a brilliant classic. And then there's another exposition of the Confession by A. Hay Hodge. These you can get free PDF. The exposition by Shaw of the Westminster Confession and the exposition by A. Hay Hodge. They are superb, and they will be a real blessing to you. But if you're just starting out in the Christian faith and you want to know some basic teaching, please get hold of this and have a read of it. You can download it for free if you just type in Westminster Confession PDF, and you'll be able to get a copy free. Go on Monergism and you'll be able to get a copy free. So if you want to listen to lectures, there are lectures on the Westminster Confession by Gressner or somebody on Legionnaire Ministries. There are 30-minute lectures on this confession, and they're really, really good lectures. A free course on Legionnaire Ministries, so please study that. It will be a blessing to you. The Barnabas Aid. We need to be praying much concerning Islam. Here is a map if I can get it. See if we can find it. It's not in here, but there is a sheet where they have a map, and it shows you the persecution that's going on with Christians and many Muslim lands, and many lands where there are Muslim extremists are engaged in jihad against Christians, and many thousands of Christians are dying because of Islamic extremism and the persecution of Christians. So you need to support Barnabas Fund, Barnabas Aid, in prayer and support them and help them. And we need to pray much concerning the rise of Islam in the West. The silly leftist people in the West, the people of the left, call it Islamophobia. These leftists are just idiots, basically. They're just absolute idiots. They don't realize that if Islam gains a foothold in the West, then Islam will demand political rights, and they will aim to make Western nations theocracies. So these leftist wets are complete utter idiots, giving more and more power to Islam. You need to ignore them. The fact of the matter is that we need to be praying as a church that God would raise up the church in the West, that the churches would awaken. We need to pray more and more. You know, we went to visit a mosque, and they're lovely people that we met, and we had some good conversation. But one of the ministers is a minister in Cardiff, and I kind of Googled information about Cardiff, and there's quite a lot of mosques in Cardiff, and I was just thinking of the Welsh Revival, We're just thinking of Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones and the great revival preachers that were in Wales, that if they were alive today, they would be so sad that Wales is dead spiritually. So we need to pray. We need to really, really pray. We've got to pray. I'm going to be praying more, and we need to be praying for our nation and the nations. Because Islam has got a grip in the West, and as Islam gets a grip, they will want to put in Sharia law, and that will take away our rights. I found that preaching in some of the northern towns, some Muslims are quite vocal in trying to stop me from preaching the gospel. Not all Muslims, but there are some. And this will increase as time goes on, so we need to pray that God would move in our nation, because we're in a desperate spiritual state. We're in a terrible state in the UK and in the West. We're really, really up against it, and we need to start praying. We need to be really, really praying. So I would encourage you to start more prayer meetings, have more watch night services. I'm going to be doing that. Have more watch night service, more prayer time for the nation and the nations. We really need to get down more and more to pray. The other thing that I want to just say something is, I was quite disturbed tonight. I was going to a church and I didn't have enough petrol and I didn't have any money on me at the time, so it was quite far away, so I turned off and went to a place called Chatterton. And I called on two churches that used to have evening services, and they didn't have any evening service on. And I drove quite a few miles, and there was no church that I could find that had an evening service. And I would just want to say to you that if you think we're going to win a nation while you're closing evening services down, you must be crazy. We need to get out of our comfort zone in the churches. We need to wake up. We need to open our churches at night on a Sunday so people can come in if they're seeking the gospel. We need to start praying more. We need to start getting out more. We need to start being on the move, folks. We really, really do. So please, please pray. Please get out. Please keep the churches open and reach out. There's so much that we need to do. Okay? That's it, really. So I'm going to close in prayer. Oh, I was just thinking about the other thing as well, is I read a paper on humanism. And I was just thinking about humanism. That one of the things about humanism is how it actually, by trying to get